This is Abnormal Entertainment.
I am a real American. Fight for the rights of every man. I am a real American. Fight for what's right. Fight for your life.
You're listening to the No Cry Zone, a progressive political podcast on the Abnormal Entertainment Network.
And welcome to the No Cry Zone, the new spring digs.
Yeah.
Approximately 20 feet away from the fallen winter digs.
But we've lost the plastic.
Yeah, it's no longer...
The plastic was scary for
right, some we're still in the Vidro facility, bunker, but we have a view out onto the landscape here. One side opened up with the weird... Whatever they grow over there.
Yeah, what's in
actually, watching them, they grow cars and boats and RVs out of there, because that's where they all were, out in the backyard there. Okay. So he must do that in the winter. So. No, I believe that, I probably shouldn't give up his name, but I believe he is a local grower that we all know and love, and that's where he grows the things before they go on sale at the local grower stand.
Wow.
There's only a couple of them, so he's one of those couple.
I don't know any of them. So.
Yeah, if you're a person who plants plants, which I am not, I think plants should take care of themselves. I'm very conservative Republican on plants.
They should take care of themselves.
Yep, exactly. And they should take care of themselves and not need to be pruned or hedged or clipped or okay. done any of that.
Well, it's freeloading welfare plants.
Yep.
That I think we should actually raise their rent.
Yep.
Much like the HUD is about to do. It's trying to pass through Congress.
Oh, is that to cover all of Hannity's loans?
Yeah, you mean the new stakeholder in HUD?
No, and it's, who's it? Carson yes. is proposed the raising, because there's the $50 low-income rent
right.
Rule. And he wants to raise that to $150.
Look, that table is not going to buy itself.
It shall not buy itself. Okay.
They gave away billions and billions of dollars to rich people. They have to increase the fees to make the government work. I mean,
right.
all and the fees. I mean, they're talking about the state parks. They're talking about the licenses. Everything that they can increase a fee on, they're
well,
going to increase
Oh, of course.
Fee.
Oh, absolutely. But I think it's interesting you bring up HUD, and especially because of what we've learned about Hannity in this last week, and that here is this boy... is the poster child for welfare queens. You know, and the public has been indoctrinated into a image of what a welfare queen is, and of course it is nothing, looks nothing like Sean Hannity, and yet
right.
Sean Hannity is actually what the welfare queens look like. I mean, this is a guy who has, what is it, $90 million?
Mm-hmm.
Was it some figure
yeah, 90
like
million.
That?
Yeah, that was the thing.
Of, you know, homes
yeah,
that are...
800 homes, yeah. about $90 million, and as soon as Carson took over, it bumped up $5 million right there
well,
in the last
well, this
year.
This was a bonus.
Yeah,
signing
like,
bonus.
It was like a little bonus, a little cash grab.
So, to note, not illegal.
No, but...
Morally reprehensible.
Yes.
But not illegal.
All the while preaching against the evils of government. And, of course, a lot of that money was... invested over the 8 years of the Obama administration.
Mm-hmm.
So here's a guy taking complete advantage of government contracting, and not contracting, but government largesse to increase his portfolio and also increase the government's obligation to his bottom line.
So do you think journalistic ethics apply to Sean Hannity?
Well, no, of course not.
Yeah, that's because people were crying out, you know, with the Cohen thing, and you know, he should have.
I mean, they should, but
they
don't.
No, they shouldn't. He's no journalist.
Right.
He doesn't even call himself one. He's a hate entertainer, a hatertainer.
Right. And the fact that's
a new thing.
Hey, copyright trademark. And the fact that Fox News didn't really even bat an eye when this, you know...
Less than bad. They probably gave him a bonus.
I mean...
Like, good job.
Yeah, I'm sure he got ratings out of it.
It should dispel any notion. But again, not that it matters. We already knew what Fox News was.
Right.
And for those that were predisposed to think that Fox News is the only true information out there, this doesn't bother them.
No, it's not going to damage them. Yeah, I mean, so. it's a case of good for him, as, you know, good for him making money off of when he can.
See how smart he is?
Unless he's the Clinton.
Right.
And then, then it's evil. Then they're not allowed to make any
money. Right, of course. Yeah, they should be shot.
She gets paid speaking fees. Everyone gets paid speaking fees. What is wrong with you? What is wrong?
What I really like is that as we head into the midterms and then even looking out in 2020, it's clear that Hillary Clinton is still running, whether she is or not. She is going to be center point of every Republican campaign.
Apparently, because I saw a great meme. It was her and Bill. They were walking along, and she had one of those weird Asian-styled jackets on, those long ones, and he was wearing a members-only jacket. And it said that Bill Clinton's fashion is Steven Seagal from the 80s, and Hillary Clinton's is Steven Seagal now. I was dying, because I hate Steven Seagal.
Yeah.
It's such a passion. But yeah, she's running, whether she wants to or not. She's running.
Right. I don't mean that she's running. She's not going to run. But I just mean that they're making her the center, because they've got nothing else.
It's like she's running.
Yeah, they've got nothing else.
That, you know, she's running. Bill Clinton's sexual escapades are page one 25 years later again.
Meanwhile, as the actual president of the United States is dealing with... The list is too long to go into.
Can we talk about the absolute hypocrisy of white evangelicals?
Again? Yes.
No, just in still. I still can't get over it. It still bugs me. And I know it shouldn't. I know that, you know, much like, you know, Sean Hannity's not a journalist, you're not real Christians, we get it. We understand. But I still think we have to apply something to them.
Well, for me personally, I mean, I can't control how anyone else deals with them or thinks about them or whatever, but I just know for me personally, if an evangelical, if I came across, had a conversation, an interaction with somebody who was an evangelical, and I don't believe anything they believe, I mean, we have a completely different worldviews, but I would give them the courtesy of, you're allowed your views, that's fine, I don't agree with you, but we'll interact, and I'll interact in a courteous way, and that's okay, you go your way, I'll go mine. Now, I don't feel under any obligation, and, you know, oh yes, let you have your say. You deserve a right to say, even as wrong as I think you are, you deserve a right to have your opinion and say it out loud and whatever. And now I feel like, no, you know what, I'm under no obligation to listen to you, not that I ever was, but I don't even need to give you the courtesy, I guess is what I'm getting at, if you're an evangelical and have voted for Donald Trump or support Donald Trump. You don't even deserve the time of day any longer.
It's weird. It's like, so we all have our own points of view, you know. I'm irascible. John is angry most of the time. Rob is living in a world where it's a crazy world. But we set the laws of our world. We set the laws and we obey the laws of our worldview. They have set the laws of their worldview along the teachings of Jesus Christos, Jesus Christ, and they completely ignore them.
What has changed is the Republican Right Party has used the idea of they are losing ground in the battle of religion of the world, and they are becoming obsolete as a weapon against them to take up their attention. I mean, I really do think that was what all of this election was, is people not really being obsolete, but fearing being obsolete. And it was all based on, well, this guy is going to take my place where I am, and I'm going to be down in his place soon. And it was all a reversal of fortune, was the thing that they were preaching over and over and over. Soon this will all flip, and you'll be the guy on the bottom. And that is the dog whistle of the century. I don't think anybody else is actually going to use that even better in the next whole 85 years coming.
What does it say about your worldview, though, if you look at the world and you go, wow, the world is changing, and my socioeconomic place in it is changing, and your solution to that is, I mean, for me, you look at that and you go, wow, the world is changing, and me, a white male, my traditional dominance in this hierarchy is being upended, or at least being altered. My view on that, you look at it and you go, all right, well, How can I adapt and fit into this new hierarchy? What's my best way forward? What does it say about your worldview when you look at that and you go, all right, how do I fuck those guys that are changing? How do I... They got to go down so I can go up. I mean, thought to, like, how do I fit into this or how do I adapt? It's just simply, how do I undercut somebody else in order to keep my dominance?
I think it's almost even a little less sinister, but still evil in the way that they talk about morals and religion talks about having good morals. As soon as it's against another group, they're, all bets are off. And it is more of a... I understand that the rules have been written for me to have dominance in this society, and I do not want those rules to change. More or less, I want them to change for me in this way. It's like, we already realize that we have the top of the pile, and fuck all the rest of you. You know, that's what it really comes down to, and that's almost like the worst possible thing you could do as a Christian is in my mind, is to keep people down and know that you're keeping them down
right.
in order to keep yourself lofty in that
There's actually a rule against that.
Yeah. You know.
Wait, I'm trying to remember. They came up with some sort of listing.
It was like a top ten.
Didn't they write them? They almost inscribe them.
No one can read them, though, or your face will melt. I saw that
That was a documentary. I saw that, too. Yeah.
So that's why no one follows it. Read those, face melts. Okay. Who wants that?
And we've explained the current state of evangelicals.
Due to Steven Spielberg. Steven Spielberg has created evangelicals.
Well, yeah, there you go.
Wow.
Leave it to the Jew in Hollywood.
Freaking Jew.
Okay.
I don't.
And lest we single out Christians, talk about, you know, of course, Jews in this country. A major segment of American Jews are huge Trump supporters. I mean, and again, you talk about the single issue thing, where if evangelicals, they'll follow Trump to the end of the world as long as he says all the right thing, checks off all the right boxes, you know, pro-life, anti-gay, says all those things, those dog whistles that they need to hear. It's the same thing with American Jews. I mean, as long as you have this unconditional, non-questioning support for every policy that comes out of Israel, great, we don't care. We're behind you. It doesn't matter that, you know, your entire administration is catering to and devoted to neo-Nazis and fascists and white supremacists. We'll just look the other way and pretend that's not happening. So again, it's not confined to religion. I mean, Christians are doing it. The Jews are doing it. I don't know of many.
Everyone's doing it.
I don't know many Muslims.
On the Trump bandwagon?
I'm sure you'll find some, but I don't know of too many in terms of a movement that are backing Trump. But
just the ones in the Middle East that desperately did not want Hillary Clinton to be president.
Yeah, well.
Well, those are Saudi friends.
Well,
they love Trump.
Oh, they love Trump. I mean,
he's a license to print more money.
And of course, and they can look the other way. I think we're being targeted.
Yeah,
they're playing.
Don't worry about it. Just keep your head down.
You're right. Don't look.
Don't look, David. Right. Don't look up.
Yeah. If I look up, they'll think it's John. Okay. Speaking of, I got mistaken for you at Kroger the other day.
Wow. So, for those that have never seen us,
you guys should just
similar.
You should trade the mustache and beard. Right.
Well, all fat people look the same.
But you should just trade it.
It's true. All fat people look the same.
You guys, is it someone we know?
No. It was a woman. She's like, I saw you. You're on the radio. No. Sandy was there laughing her ass off.
You see, that's the unholy union, you know, that happens here in hell. Is you got David and John.
You got two fat guys.
Right.
Well, people are like, well, we can't have two because, shit, we don't have enough restaurants for two.
Mm-hmm.
And so,
nonetheless. So,
And that would be why we have separation of powers back to your... so you two can...
Oh, I thought it was because there's two fat people in the house. There'd be a separation of powers.
No, that religion and politics...
By the way,
corporations
there are
politics.
Many more than two fat people in house.
Oh, yeah, we got the sugars now.
Okay, so just to make that clear. Anyway, go on, your point.
you can't have religion and politics and corporations and politics, and when you get all three kind of intermingling, that is when you get a Hitler or a Mussolini.
Well, that's the definition of fascism.
That's why we want to keep these things separate and to keep our institutions pure of politics and partisanship and to keep those things separated. But it gets to that point of people get power hungry, you know, like, oh, we're being oppressed, so we better go and get all this stuff. And yes, that might be true, but at a certain point they kind of lose sight of their goal of, hey, we were oppressed, now we're oppressing someone else to get our ends. Mm-hmm. And that is a huge problem in society. And I do think that religion has a role to play in that, is you are able to just kind of like magically click a magic switch that, you know, this all-powerful being could have done exactly the thing that you wanted to do. And God told you to do it. You know, I guess that was my, you know, a quote from Omarosa, which I, you don't see very many quotes from, but like people were like,
no, you don't.
If you guys lose Trump and get Pence, you'll be crying for Trump. This guy's insane. He thinks Jesus talks to him. He will do anything for his religion, and that is scarier to me than Trump was. And that was a sobering fact that I think a lot of us forget is that's how close it is. We're having prayer meetings in the White House now on a regular basis. The most interviews that Trump has done to date is on the Christian Broadcast Network.
Right.
The things that are being just missed by the mainstream media are hugely important in the bigger mix of things, in the collection of power, in the collection of money, basically.
Yeah. And it's not... absolutely. I mean, yes, the mainstream media and just the public at large... we've talked about Trump fatigue, and that's it works.
Mm-hmm.
It absolutely works. The chaos that he creates, both intentionally and unintentionally, and he does both. And it's hard to tell where the dividing line on that is. But the chaos that he creates has led to this fatigue, so that when it just seems like any new revelation now, So, our Secretary of State nominee lied about serving in the Gulf War.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So what?
No one cares. Like page 8. That wasn't front page.
I mean, no one cares anymore.
We're talking to North Korea that could be magical talks. You know, it could be them exchanging ponies. Who knows what the hell they're doing over there? But I know it will not lead to them getting rid of their nuclear weapons.
Well, of course, you know. Right. You know, so you got the head of our EPA, who has a long history of being in bed with every lobbyist he can possibly get to. A great article in the New York Times last week about how when he was an Oklahoma state senator, he moved from a house. They showed a picture of the two houses. The house that he started in, which was just your typical suburban subdivision home, and then suddenly, and he's living in a mansion, like a 16-room mansion that is right across the street from the Capitol, and he's renting rooms to other legislators. He bought that house for like $100,000 less than it was worth a month after it got sold, and of course he bought it from a lobbyist for SBC Oklahoma. And so anyway, he's got this long history. So that's your EPA guy, and of course his chief deputy, who's in charge of the Superfund sites. I mean, this is the EPA's one of their biggest responsibilities is monitoring and managing these Superfund contamination sites. This guy that he brings in is an old friend of Pruitt's. And he used to be in the banking industry, and he was banned from working in the banking industry in Oklahoma. What the hell do you have to do to get banned from working in the banking industry in Oklahoma? And you got to do a fucking lot.
Okay? I'm getting banned from the malls in Alabama.
So we're not even talking about why is a guy in the banking industry handling Superfund sites. We're not even talking about that anymore. That's not even on the agenda. No one even cares about that. And no one even gives a shit about the fact that this guy is he's a crook. He's working for a crook, hired by a crook, appointed by a crook. And we could go on and on and on, and as we have ad nauseum. But no one, it hits the news cycle, people go, oh, and they go about their business.
A lot of it is feeling unable to do anything about it. You know, because our elected officials, who are, you know, supposed to represent us, should be in there vetting these people and not allowing them to take their positions. And that's been compromised.
So everything comes down to, everything's going to come down to this election, this midterm. In other words, you're right. What can we do? If the current legislators aren't going to do anything, then our opportunity is to vote them out.
Right. Something weird last night. Did you see the returns in Arizona?
I did.
The 8th District. I lived by the 8th District for a very long time. That is blood red. It is crimson, the crimson mask.
Right.
There. It is so, yeah. You know.
And they were close. They were like within five points.
5 points. Yeah. Trump took it by 21. Romney took it by 25. I know it's not a win, but from being there, that is absolutely amazing.
Right.
Amazing. And I think my concept behind it is we're hearing not the voices, but the votes of the Republican women that are fed up with this jackal.
Mm-hmm. Let's hope.
And I think the people who are disenfranchised, too, by all of it have realized that they were important. You know what I mean? The people who weren't voting realize, oh, fuck, I didn't vote, and look at what we got now.
What have I done?
I better get in there. And, you know, I went to that Democratic convention kind of like to get myself a my own little pep rally to see what the hell is my party all about. And I saw them using the fear techniques, too, and that pissed me off. But what I noticed while they were trying to do that to rile the crowd and... is the crowd was deadpan. Is these were smart people out in the crowd. These were not your rah-rah, get me all excited about this or that. They were listening for, like what I was listening for, was what is the meat? What are you guys going to go for? What is your priority one? What's your priority 10? We want to know what you're all about, or else we're not going to be voting for you. We'll be finding someone else to vote for. And it was that kind of an atmosphere. I mean, yes, you had your 14th district, which is one of our largest districts and gets a lot of people elected. If you got the 14th district here in Michigan, most likely you're going to get elected. They were pretty rah-rah. The 8th district was actually pretty rah-rah as well. But to look out at that crowd of, I guess that was probably only about 25, 100 of them, when they were trying to attempt those type of techniques of, you know, anti-Trump and anti-Republican even, the crowd would go silent. It was actually like, okay, move on. What is the plan? And it does seem
we
like
we all
that
know
was,
we're there. Yeah. All right, we don't need to talk
you know,
about
so
that.
That was actually a good feeling for me to know that it wasn't going to be this big football game, and the person with a good plan coming forward will sooner or later win out in this country. I really do believe that to the bottom of my heart.
But here's my point. And I'm glad to hear that. And you're right. That's all good sign. But what I'm worried about, and I think it's a legitimate worry, is that all of this effort and all of this concern and preparation will not translate into wins this November. Because of the depth of gerrymandering,
mm-hmm.
because of, I mean, again, we don't know how deep interference in these elections is going to go. The Russians aren't just going to do nothing,
mm-hmm.
okay? They're certainly not going to just sit back. They've had no reason to not interfere again. They haven't really been punished.
Right.
Every punishment supposedly that's come down the line has been either negated or, you know, ameliorated by Trump and his administration. So they've had no reason not to interfere. Why would they not interfere? I don't know. So I'm really worried about this November. Because you're going to have a lot of people. And what I'm worried about is this. If this election comes and we see that turnout is high and there's all this effort and enthusiasm that people put into this, and it doesn't translate into wins. In other words, look, we got to win at least the House. A bottom line is, if you don't win at least one of the chambers, then it's all green lights for Trump. It's all green light. Go Go dog go.
I guess maybe. I guess I'm seeing a different populace among Democrats. Is they are engaged? It doesn't seem like they are.
I'm not saying they're not engaged.
It doesn't seem like they're going to be quitting anytime soon.
Well, it's I'm worried though. What happens the day after that? If that election comes and we don't win, and people going to be like, "Well, motherfuck, let's roll up our sleeves and we really got to get our fucking shit together," or are they just going to go, "Oh, well, fuck the whole thing"?
Mm-hmm.
I think that there's...
That's what I'm worried about.
Probably neither of those. If there's a lot of work and a lot of effort gone into this, and there just isn't a win, then I think we're straight up, you know, revolution. I mean, there's just... people are at a boiling point. Both sides. You know, super Trump supporters, you know, how many times can you call someone a lib cuck snowflake, you know?
Yeah,
they're predisposed to be angry.
Right, right.
And if there's a bunch of effort to dispose this trash, you know, trash panda from office, then it doesn't work, you know, or just the Republicans in general, then there's the divide's going to get wider, and I think it's going to get angrier on both sides and fierier on both sides.
Right. Well, I don't want it to get violent.
No,
but
I don't want it to either, but
I worry about I guess I'm my big boogeyman, the thing I'm most worried about is apathy. Is that's what I'm really most worried about in terms of the future of our nation. Is people just going, all right.
If it were us, like a bunch of middle-aged people, I'd worry about apathy. But I see those kids from Parkland, and I see kids walking out of schools and defying their elders and their teachers and saying, "You'll suspend me. I have a belief."
All right.
Much more than we were.
Great point.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, if it was us, fuck, we're done. But we worked really hard and didn't work. Well, shit, I'm going to watch Netflix. You know, that's what would happen. But these kids don't want a world like that.
Okay, well.
They don't want the world that we're handing them, that the boomers handed us and we're handing them.
Right. All right, well, let's hope.
So that's my take on it.
Right.
Also, I think that... we don't necessarily have to take the House. I don't think we don't necessarily have to take over something because there's going to be so much ship jumping when it comes around that time. The blue wave is going to be like a red and blue wave, and as some things flip, there's going to be some Republican members of Congress changing the way they vote as well to secure their seats.
I don't know. If
but it's not going to be
the Republicans get through this election cycle and still maintain. Don't forget, if they maintain the chairmanships of these committees, and the thing is, I'm not even talking about impeachment. I'm not saying, oh, the Democrats got to take the House so they can impeach Donald Trump. I don't want to talk about impeachment unless, and I think there's plenty of grounds for impeachment. Don't get me wrong, but there's no point in even talking about it unless you can actually achieve it. So unless you have three or two-thirds of the votes in the Senate, which you don't, you're not going to have. That's a waste of time. But if you run those committees, you are an effective roadblock to the bullshit that's coming out of that White House. And if they retain the committees, if the GOP retains those committees, they can look back and say, we did not really pay a price for all the shit we did.
Yep.
We paid no price. We retained our committee chairmanships. We still run the thing. We still run the budget, and we own the White House. Oh, it's fucking green light for the next 2 years.
Right, but I don't think that's unfettered Trumpness, though.
I don't know. I think because traditionally Republicans have been worried about the next election cycle, and certainly as we've gotten closer to this one, and you've seen all these politicians going, I don't need to be here. Bye. You know, Paul Ryan and the rest.
The biggest,
okay, who are like, yeah, no thanks.
How did the third most powerful dude in politics in the U.S. just bail because he's scared?
I mean, that position, I mean, Speaker of the House just used to be a gigantic political position. I mean, in terms of power, in terms of the ability to affect policy and the course of American, you know, government, that was a major position. And now it's a junior assistant job.
There was some,
it really is.
Yeah. There was some Marine on, I believe it was even CNN, but he basically laid out the law about the war. He had some pro-war guy on saying, oh, we're just so worried about the people in Syria. And the Marine came on and said, you guys, you cannot believe this bullshit. What this is there are people with money interests in this world who have made a calculation that getting into this war will make them money. And that is what the Speaker of the House is now, is he is just the calling boy for the money. The money comes in and says, these are the things that we want you to talk about. And Boehner, in a drunken stupor one time, got quoted even saying it. Is, I am just this fucking monkey that comes out and claps my hand and then goes back into my office.
Then they gave him the toy.
Absolutely. I mean, that is simple. What the Speaker of the House is now. And people have to understand that that is not only... like the enemy, not only the enemy, but it could change all societies around the world. Having the most powerful society in the world, who gets to basically run all the games around the world, having them have that perversion of branches of society will change things irreversibly. And well, Hitler and Mussolini are the proof of
that. Well, look, the genius of what has been the genius and I guess the saving grace of the United States of America from its inception has been that separation of powers. That's the true genius of the Founding Fathers,
right.
Was to separate those powers and give them all independent...
equal power.
Equal, thank you, good point. Equal and separate but equal power and independent of each other.
Yeah.
And... in the last century, in the 20th century, from World War II forward, you've seen increasing power invested in the executive branch,
right.
and more power. And I know people sometimes will say, "Well, look at Obama. I mean, you had the Congress consistently thwarting his legislative agenda, which would lead them to believe that somehow the legislative was accruing power, and really it wasn't." The executive power has only increased in the past 65, 70 years, and it's only going to increase. And this current abdication of legislative authority, oversight, it only makes it that much worse. I mean, you talk about Syria, this is where the executive branch has gone just haywire, in the fact that no longer is Congress involved in war-making decisions. Something
right.
that it's absolutely defined in the Constitution, and we've allowed it. Just by consensus, we've allowed that power now to reside almost entirely in the executive branch. The executive branch can decide when we go to war. They justify it one way or the other, and they play the game. But the Congress is never involved in this, and they don't want to be. Look what happened with Obama with the red line in Syria. And he said, all right, Congress, you give me your, what do you think we ought to do? And Congress went, we should go on vacation. Bye.
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't do anything.
Right.
And politically
largely
speaking.
The same Congress.
and it gave Obama the political cover to not do anything. And we can debate that if you want. But I'm just saying the Congress was given an opportunity to weigh in and put its oversight on the line. And they walked away from it. And consistently that's what happened. With the executive branch being invested, with the power that it's being invested in, especially an executive branch that has sole authority over the use of nuclear weapons. And again, I'm not trying to scare anybody or, you know, overstate the case, but really, it is scary. I mean, we've invested one man, literally one man and one man only, with in the absolute 100% power to decide when and if those weapons will be used. The entire system is built on obeying that man no matter what. We train these guys, these men and women in the nuclear forces, they are trained to not ask questions.
Yep.
Do not ask any questions. Turn the key, push the button, shut the fuck up. That's what they're trained to do. And this entire system is built on this. This is where you're talking about the danger of the world. That's what made me think of this. This is the danger to the world. This is the danger to the future of humanity. That this country, which has this overwhelming, immense power, is completely haywire in terms of the balance. Mm-hmm. The balance of power is way, way off. And I don't know what we're going to do to rebalance it.
What it's going to take is someone in the White House that sees it and abdicate some of that power.
Right, gives it back.
That's the only thing that can happen.
You're right.
The seeing part is Obama talking about your red line is he got all the supposedly the chemical weapons out, and he left the trap door in there that the Russians were supposed to oversee the program, and if it ever happened again, we were supposed to blame the Russians. And now we have a news cycle that whenever you say Russian, you're either a crazy libtard or a Trump supporter, one or the other.
Right.
That's all you are.
Right.
And Russia has actually won this game of allowing this thing to happen. And then to go back to your corporations and government getting together, if you allow that to happen, which is what we're doing, we're allowing that to happen. We have our weapons makers on these type of strikes. Not only are we allowing one man to do it, but we're letting the weapons makers lobby the people who actually push the buttons to make their weapon go off so that their stock will rise the next day. The Tomahawk weapon went up 5% the next day. That's billions of dollars of these people's pockets just because they went and blew up some empty buildings. So, yes, this is a wag the dog. I heard you guys talk about that on the last podcast. I do think that some of this is a wag the dog issue. It might not have been for Comey's book, but I do think that he plays with these toys as any powerful man in a very weird bubble would. You know, he is in a dictator's mind bubble, in my opinion. And he does. We got the way cleared. I mean, he gave notice, enough notice to know that those people were going to be evacuated from those buildings. God, we got to have so many planes flying over that. You know, like in the Cuba Missile Crisis, we had to send up the U-2s, and we were still getting excellent pictures. We can send them on the deck now. We can run them right across and see what the fuck is going on there. We knew that those people were getting evacuated out of those buildings, and yet we still pushed the button. Why did we send all those millions of dollars across to do that? That is just a game. That's a press game that he's playing with all of this to distract from Pruitt and DeVos and all of these other guys who are actually dismantling, taking away those safeguards that we had to insulate the branches is the big story that we're all missing.
I still don't think it's him distracting. I think he's being played to distract people.
I think that's what
I think he's playing with toys.
Closer.
you're
closer to the truth, David. Yeah.
I think
your point's all valid.
But he's being shown two different options that he can do, and one will make him look weak, and the other one will make him look strong, and they're playing him, just like they played Truman to drop the bomb, just like all of these guys get played to a certain extent by these lobbyists, because they're the ones who got them there, it's their money that got them there.
The sad part is he's getting played by his cabinet, who are influenced by the lobbyists. Now.
Right. Well, they are lobbyists. There is no separation there anymore.
We've drained the swamp right into the White House.
Mm-hmm. And there you go.
But I do think, after all of that doom and gloom, I do think that we will have, John, an awakening of people. I was looking for the Boy Scout. I was expecting the Boy Scout, the way they were talking and screaming, and it was a political rally. I mean, I was expecting people to be all rah-rah and holding up their signs and doing their whole big thing like you see on TV, and it wasn't. It was.
Well, you expected the jamboree.
Well, kind of, I expected the jamboree. I expected people to be just excited, but you could tell when a poignant point came up, that's when they got excited. It got me excited. So I do think the intelligent people of the world who were disenfranchised by government will wake up and go, oh my God, I was important.
Hallelujah! Praise the Lord!
So that's all I can say to be helpful in this matter, because if I don't, I'm going to turn into that, like, I'll just give up, because it's every day. It's every news cycle. There is something new. And it's crazy. And I was even asking my dad the other day, was Nixon like this? He's like, oh no.
It's funny you bring that up, because I read a column where someone was talking about the difference between Nixon and Trump. It's not even in the scope of what they're doing,
right?
Because there's a lot of similarities in terms of usurping authority and power.
Yeah.
What they said the difference was is that a lot of Nixon's rants and a lot of his inner feelings, we only know about those after the fact,
right?
Because of the tapes.
Right.
Okay. He did all that in private.
In private.
All right. Trump does it publicly. He holds rallies.
Yep.
And does it right out in front to the public with the media right there on purpose. And on so purpose, they hold similar views, similar cynical views of themselves and their place in the world and what the world is there. But Nixon, at least, whatever you want to say about Nixon, and I can't say a lot good about him, but at least he understood that there was some decorum to be held, although I guess at the end of the day, he used it as a cover to try and subvert. So, but Trump is just out in front, just saying it out loud.
Yeah.
I mean, and these rallies that he continues to hold are one of the bigger things that I think is, I would hate to see that become a tradition now.
Yeah.
In well, American you know politics.
It is. And where, it's going to have to.
Where, now, beyond Trump.
Yep,
beyond Trump. Mm-hmm. But now that it's going to be seen as, okay, once you win the White House, then you got to continue to rally.
You got
to
go on a little tour afterwards.
And you got to keep it going. Mm-hmm. You can't let it die down because, and it's like, in other words, you can't ever just actually fucking do your job.
Yeah.
You know? I guess one of the biggest things you can say, one of the biggest critiques of Donald Trump is, I guess, just how lazy he is. Of all the malevolent things that he has done and said, his absolute laziness, I think, is probably one of the things that is most egregious in my mind in terms of to hold a position like the presidency of the United States of America and to do as little as this man does is just breathtaking.
Well, Obama's quote on that was, is he didn't realize that he was supposed to do that. And maybe that's what a president is supposed to do, is maybe they aren't really supposed to set policy, which is what Obama would come out and do. And that was a quote from somebody that just drove me mad that Obama was so bad because he was so fucking smart. Yeah. Oh, my God, I wanted to punch him. Oh, he was just so smart. Well, God damn it, we want a smart guy there.
You would think,
right? The only thing that they appreciated about him was, look how much he can get done. And I kept on thinking, you know who else gets things done? Is the mafia. The mafia gets shit done, too. You know, they don't take no for an answer, and it gets done. And Russia thought that was a great thing after the wall fell down. Hey, you know what? We don't have a government. Let's let the mafia take over.
And who else?
And look who, it's another one of those unholy unions, is now we have mafia and corporation and government and religion.
And James Comey was another person who's made that connection.
Yep.
That mafia.
Yep.
Like, he felt like, you know, here's a guy who prosecuted the mafia when he was a federal prosecutor, and he felt like, when he was talking to Trump, like, this is like being in the family.
Yep.
You know, they want loyalty. It's like dealing with the mob boss. It is a management style. Mm-hmm. And, as you know, if you look at Trump's history, of course, that's always how he's run it. Him at the center, very few but very loyal people around. He doesn't have a lot of employees.
Yeah.
He doesn't want a lot of employees. He wants people to give him absolute loyalty. And
the ones that are close in that inner circle are basically like satellites. They're satellite programs that he can't handle himself, but they will report back to him and do exactly as he asked them to do. He might not know anything on the subject, but they report into him and give him those options, just like David was saying about this. And he's easily manipulatable. And I think North Korea did the same thing. They manipulated him by, your hair is so wonderful, I can't believe that your country hates you, or you know, whatever they were, you know, they used as a tactic. I think it's easy enough to understand that that's what you can do to this man.
I mean, you just had Trump the other day say Kim Jong-un is a very honorable man. I'm like, what?
Yeah.
Very honorable?
Yeah.
The man is a brutal, murderous dictator, and we're going to call him honorable? And why is he honorable? Because he's in Trump's mind, he's assisting Trump's agenda.
Mm-hmm.
That's all it takes. It doesn't matter what you do.
Right.
It doesn't matter if you brutally suppress and kill people, and whether you gas them or starve them or shoot them. No one gives. He doesn't give a shit about that.
Right.
But you're assisting my agenda. You're very honorable.
Mm-hmm.
And when I talk about his laziness,
and don't I mean, many presidents are like that.
I'm not saying we haven't catered to dictators.
You can't just lay that on Trump. I mean, Saudi Arabia does the same thing, and the Bushes got them out of here right after 9/11. So, I mean, we have special places for people who go along.
I agree. A point well taken. We have a long history of catering to dictators. Yeah. I'm not trying to say this is new to Trump.
Yes.
New with Trump.
No.
But back to the laziness thing, here he is. He's preparing supposedly for this. He's preparing for this summit with Kim Jong-un. You know, here, this is a historic opportunity. Here's something, if you're Trump and all the shit that you've taken, all the crap that has come your way, and here you've managed to get this summit. I mean, this, if you're Donald Trump and you can walk out of that summit and truly a real deal, not a fake deal,
right,
but really walk away with some sort of deal that solves the Korean crisis. Now, that's not going to happen, don't get me wrong.
Right.
But you have an opportunity to make it happen. You don't ever see leader-to-leader talks. From all indications, he is not at all preparing for this.
No.
When his intelligence agencies and his diplomatic corps want to brief him on preparing for this. It's coming up next month, I think. They want to prepare him for this, and his attitude has been, reportedly, although I believe it, has been, just get me in the room with him and I'll cut a deal. I mean, that's the guy's attitude about everything. If it were me, you, or any other sentient human being, wouldn't you be scared shitless? In terms of, I don't want to fuck this up.
Yeah.
There's so many pieces in play here. There's so much on the line. So many people's lives and futures are on the line here. Like, I really got to fucking figure out what I'm doing here so I don't fuck it up. He doesn't care.
See, that
he never fucks anything up
that's
in his mind.
Where he is different than any other. Any of those other ones that we if you would have brought up a whole shitstorm about the Saudis at the time, something might have changed with the Bush administration. But with Trump, you bring up that shitstorm, it doesn't matter. He will just go ahead and do what he wants, thinking it's in his best interest, until it's not, and then he'll change his mind,
right,
just like on the TPP. Everybody's right, just screaming at him. We know it's a bad deal. We know it's a bad deal. Keep in the driver's chair. You're in the driver's chair. Don't get out. Don't get out. But he goes fucking crazy. Cone of silence as soon as experts start talking to him. He's thinking he can know best when he doesn't, and nope, I'm out. This will send a message, and that's what he was trying to do to the rest of the world. Is we're going to be isolated. You are going to start talking to us one on one. We're not doing these multilaterals. We're the king shit. But he didn't realize this. He had that position already, and
right.
I don't think he realizes that with North Korea, is he has the king shit position already. He has it already.
China has it. China, because of TPP, China has it.
Right.
China's king shit, and as far as North Korea is concerned right now.
Yeah, true.
And Trump, if he's smart, will be a Chinese puppet here and make it all better on the face. Because Abe doesn't care. Or not Abe. Who's the Chinese president?
Who's the woman.
That guy.
Yeah, the dude.
You know him.
Yeah,
president of China. He's completely fine not being the figurehead for this one.
Yeah,
but you just said something that was absolutely genius.
President Xi.
Yeah.
XI.
Gotcha.
Pronounced Xi.
President Xi. And so we are asking ourselves, what appeals about Trump? What the hell appeals about Trump to people? What do they like about it? Just like a vast majority of the American public, he rejects expertise.
Right.
Mm-hmm. He doesn't believe that expertise exists.
Yep.
If I can't understand it, it's wrong.
Which is the result of 40 years of Republican doctrine.
Right.
This is what you end up
and
with.
And calling out elitism.
Right. Exactly. But rejecting... Right. Exactly. Trying to... Labeling anything that is against you as elite and then rejecting all... academic and any kind of fact-based or expert advice as unnecessary to label it that. But it's the result of, like I said, four decades of Republican policy.
And he's in religion.
That's part of the policy.
Yeah, that's part of magic thinking there too.
Yeah,
and it's he's not a result of Trump is not a result of this. He's a member of it.
Yeah.
That's kind of what I'm trying to get at. You know, he's like Harrison Bergeron. You know, just like, who won the lottery for president today?
Well, Joe Schmo did. All right, Joe Schmo, you're the president.
When's this movie going to end?
Shit, we're in like the third sequel. Well, this is like a Bond series.
If we could ever get some of that military budget to come back towards cybersecurity and more intelligence community, that, I mean, they're all screaming for more money too. And that was another big thing with the budget that nobody kind of at all just
shut up.
We just went all past it. Just, oh yeah, it's just all going to the military. No one asked how much. For this new big threat, are we going to put together?
You can fire a tomahawk at the internet. Yeah. That's how it works.
Yeah, I didn't get the stock.
I blew up the internet.
This control, delete, screw that. I'm just firing a tomahawk.
Trump's other like, Kardashian's going to blow up the internet, and we're safe.
Well, you know, that was an argument I had recently about the nuclear weapons in North Korea, was that they're nuclear weapons. Yes, I understand the nuclear weapons, but they're nuclear weapons with no budget. It's like having a Ferrari with no tires. You can't afford the $5,000 set of tires to be able to go and drive the damn thing.
It's got tires. They're just made out of wood.
Yeah, right.
And so, they're square.
Right.
and running on computers with floppy disks. And you know, you could. It's just like our border discussion. It's just about any discussion that you can have about government policies is there are a million ways to skin the cat. How are you going to allocate those assets?
Right.
If you were to put whatever we just put in the military, which we didn't need because Obama was already paring it down to what we needed, if we were to take all of that money and put it in our intelligence community and cyber defense and even like missile defense for other missiles that are obviously going to be coming from us from the brown countries that Donald is pissing off, but all of those things put into place, how would it change the world? It would immediately make everything safer. You know, this perpetual state of war.
What was
state
the Obama
warhead.
Was changing something. He was removing a line item from the military budget that people were just all up in arms for, but I think it was like for bayonets or something like that. He was like removing the line item for bayonets and saving like $3.5 million and just stockpiling bayonets because,
And that was the other thing, it wasn't just removing a bayonet, he was giving them a knife. Giving them a side knife instead of a, you know, put on the end of your rifle knife. So you had this knife, and what many of the soldiers would do is they would affix it to their rifle if they really wanted a bayonet.
The duct tape requisitions went up monumentally.
But, you know,
and that's what messed everything up.
Well, see, that's where the budget issues is people, you know, this is what you find out on C-SPAN, and you just sit there for hours and hours and hours, and they go through this shit. Where it's just insane. You know, we've all heard about the ashtray. Well, that's a real regulation that an ashtray cannot break into less than 27 pieces or whatever. So that, therefore, it makes an ashtray cost, instead of $11, $33, because the glass guy's got to make it different to, you know, fulfill the government contract. But he's happy to do it because he has a government contract and he can charge whatever he wants.
Right.
So that's what Obama was in the process of doing with our military. And he had found all of these billions and billions and billions of dollars that were just missing in the books. I mean, where did they go? Oh, this contractor didn't finish his project, but we still gave him the money. Don't worry, it's fine. We're not going to do that one anymore, but then we're going to do this one. And I remember getting into a fight at the time about one of these planes that goes up and has a laser that can shoot down on the ground. It was a, you know, so you could go up into the battlefield and basically just like Star Wars and laser up things. Obama was getting rid of it because it was 20 years late in its project, it was costing billions of dollars, it was a cool weapon, it might have worked, but it would have cost us billions and billions more to actually make it functional and get out onto the field. So these type of things in the budget are in there, and we don't realize it. We just say, oh, give them more! It's the military! Here, give them more! Well, they don't need more. They really don't. What they need is an accountant to go through and say, okay, you guys are wasting all this money. As soon as you get rid of all your waste, you can have it again.
But then the political optics are, Hates the troops.
Yeah, hates the troops.
Hates the troops.
Right, but I mean, you talk about line items on like bayonets or even bigger things, but all you have to do is like look at the F-35. Okay, that's the Joint Strike Fighter.
Yeah,
that is a ridiculous boondoggle. I mean, an unbelievable that spans multiple administrations, Republican and Democratic. I mean, and they cannot get rid of this fucking piece of shit.
Yeah,
that is a ridiculous. I think it costs $95 million each, and we've committed to buying 2,600 of them, and they don't work. By the way, they're not.
And the pilots don't want
them. The pilots don't want them because there's a problem with their oxygen system. Several pilots have died. There have been crashes. And none of these planes, it's been deployed since 2013, none of these planes are in frontline units by purpose because the military is like, well, don't put those there. They'll just crash and blow up. And so we're paying all this money for these show planes that they're going to look wonderful at the air show.
I've got a plan.
All right. But
for those,
yeah, and so if anything exemplifies what you're talking about there, it's that.
I've got a plan.
Okay, I'm sorry. What's the plan?
I'm gonna fix everything.
What's the plan?
I'm gonna take that self-driving Uber technology, put them in those, and then when the aliens attack, we'll just fly the planes into their ships.
Ah, but
use them as suicide bombers.
But wait a minute. What about Dennis Quaid? Or, I'm sorry,
in the words of my generation, John, of yours.
Okay. Ron Quaid, but anyway, Randy Quaid.
Randy Quaid.
Yeah, I meant Randy.
What about Dennis Quaid? He's happy Randy's dead.
He's not the only one. So, that's a whole pile of weird there. Anyway, that's a different podcast.
I bet he's a Trump supporter.
Yeah. So, we have a state visit going on right now.
Yes.
First state visit of the Trump administration.
The huggy-feely French.
Yes.
Lots of touching yesterday.
President Macron. Yeah.
Lots of, you know, some hand jives, some smooching, some shoulder grabbing.
Let's start with the hand jive. Of course, I don't know if you've seen the video of Trump trying to take Melania's hand and his fingers probing, which I hate, sorry to use that phrase, but his fingers probing for her hand.
She's used to it.
And her hand being like, no. And she's trying to like retract her hand into her sleeve. And finally grabs a couple fingers like, God!
You know, maybe she wasn't and her hand, arm was naturally shrinking away from her. Like, and it just,
you know, I've laughed at it, I've largely tried to avoid the gossipy stuff about their marriage and whether she, you know, hates him or whatever. But it is almost impossible not to come to the conclusion, especially after seeing the happy, joyous look on her face at Barbara Bush's funeral when she's sitting next to Obama. Did you see that picture?
Who's smooth?
Okay.
He's a smooth character.
Yeah. You know, and I'm looking at this and I'm like, she never smiles unless she's with Obama, apparently. Right.
That and the weird friendship between Michelle Obama and W.
Yeah,
that's something
there, that's a whole different.
I enjoy it sort of. Yeah. Like, this is so weird.
It is an odd thing, but there's something. Not that that has anything to do with anything that really matters, but
right.
There's just something.
It's sort of kind of because apparently she planned the state dinner
right.
flawlessly,
which. You know,
okay. I mean, the first lady's job is to plan these things and set them up. So I'm like, hey, you know, there is a Trump out there. Does their job right.
Except for inviting about 200 people that would normally come. Normally Democrats.
Right, no Democrats and no...
the Obamas were doing like big deals and she got it all into one room. So.
Yeah, this probably by design and request.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sure it was by demand.
Yeah.
So
I'm going to hold two fingers and no Democrats. Okay. Your dinner. Yeah.
So the touchy feely stuff,
and I'm gonna touch Macron more than you.
Oh yeah,
all over.
Which he did.
Oh.
Which he said, if you saw the dandruff wipe,
yeah, the germaphobe.
Yeah,
the confessed germaphobe that could never get peed on by a prostitute is moving dead human skin off of the French president.
Right. Now it's been pointed out, and of course, so here at this moment, you're in the Oval Office, the press is there. It's one thing, it'd be bad enough, it'd be inappropriate and bad enough if, while there, he just reached over and wiped something off his shoulder. That'd be wrong and inappropriate and don't, what are you doing? That's bad enough. But to go, I'm wiping the dandruff off your shoulder as he does it. What is going through, and Macron just has this look of like, what is happening? What the fuck is going on?
If this dinner wasn't so good, I wouldn't even be here.
So,
he knows Macron is more powerful than he is.
Right. Oh, yeah. The whole thing was a jockey. Yeah. Well, the handshake jockeying that turned into like some weird, we just made a layup 3-on-3 basketball celebration with the handshake. The weird diving in for the cheek kiss. Just absolutely bizarre, and it's one-upsmanship, it's showmanship, it's body language dominance that Trump totally lost.
Right.
And Macron lost, too, because he's playing it with an idiot.
Yeah.
So I mean, they both look foolish. And then he has to bring up the French president has dandruff. That trumps even the Angela Merkel backer up from W.
Oh, my God.
You're right. It's so bizarre.
Yeah.
So
it is annoying, though, that, I mean, really, there's so much tension there for other reasons that our press spends the amount of time and the short amount of time that we actually get news stories out of them on this type of stuff. It annoys me, and that is my shutoff point these days.
It's annoying.
As soon as they start getting into that, I go,
but,
fuck.
You know, what are you going to do?
Gotta be done. Gotta be done.
The minute they start talking about corporations and politics, click.
Yeah, that's
off. So the only way we can sow dissent for this guy is, pop culture style.
Yeah, right? And that is what they all want to report.
Although it's been, I don't know if you've seen the quote from Jane Goodall, the anthropologist, who was somebody now talking about the dandruff swipe. There's a thing that's making but basically she did write. She did talk in an article for Atlantic in October 2016. She said, in many ways, the performance of Donald Trump reminds me of male chimpanzees and their dominance rituals. In order to impress rivals, males seeking to rise in the dominance hierarchy perform spectacular displays, stamping, slapping the ground, dragging branches, throwing rocks. The more vigorous and imaginative the display, the faster the individual is likely to rise in the hierarchy and the longer he is to maintain that position. So it's interesting, these displays that he makes of, like, it is a dominance display, whether it's conscious on his part or not. But I mean, there's no other way to describe it, that to do this, because here you have Macron, who's much younger than he is, much more intelligent, much more just fill in the blank, everything
more beloved in his country
than Trump. So I thought it was funny because Macron got his back today. He addressed Congress.
Oh, and they loved him.
Yeah. He urged the United States, so standing in front of Congress, dandruff boy, sit down. He goes, he urged the United States to reject fear and isolationism, instead embrace the historic bond between the two countries to launch a new era of 21st century leadership. He talked about the Iran nuclear deal, how important it was to keep that in place, free trade, and the Paris Accord on climate change. So he used this opportunity. It's like, okay, you can brush the dandruff off me if you want. I'm instead going, yeah, that's your little display, good for you, you feel better about it. I'll go stand in front of your Congress and basically say everything you're doing is wrong.
Right.
All right? Yeah, and you tell me which is the dominance display.
But it was widely reported that he did that, too.
Yeah, I was just going to say, I bet you it's not 50-50, though. I bet you I bet you there's more about the dandruff than you can find about his speech.
More about the dandruff last night. Today was all, it's all about Macron just being charming.
Yeah.
And charming shit out of the joint session.
And I think that is, if you go back to the chimpanzee point, is like they work a room too. Like, if they're, you put, in whatever their area, their little tribe, if they think they can get up the line, they'll do that amongst this group, or but not this group, kind of like a herding thing that we've talked about. And Trump makes that calculation. Like, that's why he won't go to that correspondence dinner.
Right.
He knows that calculation is a losing calculation. He will not be able to control that room.
Even just showing
up. And with a Macron in his house, in his country, I guess, he makes that calculation of, I am going to try and keep the spotlight on me throughout this whole thing, even though it is not possible with a personality like Macron.
So, Trump, you're right. Trump, you're a correspondence center? Oh, hell no, that's not his crowd. Yeah. And if he doesn't have to do it, he won't do it. I mean, he doesn't even, I'm sure, want to speak in front of Congress, but he has to. So, all right, fine. The rallies that he holds, that's where he's in his true element.
Right.
I mean, that's the real,
because he can hold that spotlight of
absolutely.
The room. The whole room looks at him.
Where he has a therapy session on stage.
Yeah.
I mean, he, like, unburdens his entire bag of neuroses out onto the stage and just lets the crowd adore him.
Yeah, I mean, he learned something from the G8s and stuff. You know, you get there with a bunch of world leaders, you're not, no one thinks you're a world leader.
Right.
Yeah. It's okay. You get to talk to Putin.
Yeah.
Go have fun.
Yeah, exactly.
You
right.
guys chat it up. We're gonna run the world. You guys try and thwart us. Oh, that's the division of labor at the G8.
Well, and you know the one thing that out of Macron that you just read was leadership, and that's, you know, if you want to write the laws and be the man with the gold, you better be one of the leaders. You know, and if you isolate yourself amongst the other leaders and say, oh no, we're the best. Well, guess what? They're going to, you know, join forces behind you and go rule the world without you.
Yeah.
And we'll just move on. There is nothing that isolation, even when we were talking about it before World War II, there is nothing about isolation that allows your country to be the leader of the world. If you are completely trying to be an isolationist country and keep it, which he isn't, which is, it's just words for him. But for
it's
others,
real for his followers.
Yeah, for his followers, it's real. But in that vein is you are just losing power, and I don't understand why his followers don't see it that way.
Right.
They can't.
And I don't
see
want
it.
To.
Yeah.
It's the power of love.
It's a beautiful thing.
I don't know.
It makes one man leap and another man sing.
I already ended a podcast with the power of love. We're not ending it with that.
Oh, no, okay. We should end it with.
Okay.
My pick for the next nominee for something in the White House staff, Amy, the smart sign language ape from Congo.
Okay,
I think because now we were doing the chimpanzee rituals.
Oh maybe, right. Maybe, oh okay. Even the movie Congo.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Not
okay.
From the Congo.
Oh yeah. I was like, I'm confused. All right.
From the movie Congo.
Okay.
Or you know maybe the silverback from Rampage. I mean whatever.
Sure.
You know, we need a real gorilla for him to start.
Kind of like Reagan's Bonzo?
Maybe Reagan was way ahead of his time.
I think he might. Reagan was the original Rock. Think about it. Actor with a chimpanzee, and here's Rock with his movie Rampage.
We missed out on electing Michael Jackson then. Was that Bobo? Was his monkey's name?
Oh, I forgot his monkey's name.
Michael Jackson's monkey.
Wow.
Bobo. I think it was Bobo.
Bobo the monkey?
Bobo the monkey.
Okay.
Yeah, and we all know that and have that in our fucking brains. Isn't that just depressing? I mean, it's there. It's been there for 30 years now that Michael Jackson has a monkey. So I think that is a terrible idea, David, as he will just won't lose elections if he has a monkey. It will take America's attention.
What do you think the monkey starts making decisions, though, and things get better?
Maybe he is already.
It was Bubbles.
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 Yeah. Well, you can talk contact with the research team.
Yes. Wikipedia.
Man, they are quick.
Wiki and the Peds.
So. Well, we've come to a halt here. So.
I made a gorilla angry once at the zoo.
Did you?
Okay. Yeah. I walked up to the window and with Sandy and my niece Sid, my wife and my niece, and apparently it was challenge time for my ladies, so he rushed it, did the chest beating, was screaming at me, and I'm like, well, it's on. So I had to do the same thing back, and who left with the ladies? This guy right here, because I wasn't in the cage.
Yeah.
All right.
So
you win.
Yeah, me and Jane Goodall, we win.
Now I'm the king of the swingers, oh, the jungle VIP. I've reached the top and had to stop, and that's what's bothering me. I want to be a man cub, and stroll right into town, and be just like the other men. I'm tired of monkeying around. Oh, ooby-doo, I want to be like you. I want to walk like you, talk like you, too. You see, it's true. An ape like me can learn to be human, too.
Find more episodes of The No Cry Zone at thenocryzone.com. Tweet Rob, John, and Dave at No Cry Zone, and find The No Cry Zone on Facebook. Listen to every Abnormal Entertainment show on Google Play, Apple Podcasts, our YouTube channel, or anywhere you find your favorite podcasts. And don't forget to visit abnormalentertainment.com.
You've been listening to the Abnormal Entertainment Network.